to show good faith is a humble yet powerful way to live out our own faith in front of others. When we can learn to do that, to listen to the perspective of others, to understand where they are coming from, we can then show them the love of God, and we can do all of this in good faith.
We are starting a brand new series today, and we're going to be talking about in good faith. You know, good faith is one of those terms that demonstrates your seriousness about something. Most of the time, it's used in financial transactions. If you're going to buy a house, you have to give a good faith deposit. And so this term, good faith, has been come to known that you are serious about your intentions. You're serious about what you say you're going to do. And most of the time, we just think about money. But reality, if we apply this term to our faith, good faith in our actions, good faith in our thoughts, good faith in what we really believe, all of a sudden it is a humble yet powerful way to demonstrate to anybody who knows us or anybody watching what we're really all about. So, Mark chapter 12, let's read the scripture first and then we'll continue talking about it. Mark chapter 12, starting in verse 28. One of the scribes approached, and when he'd heard them debating and saw that Jesus answered them well, he asked him, "Which command is the most important of all?" Jesus answered, "The most important is, 'Listen, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other command greater than these.' Then the scribe said to him, 'You are right, teacher. You have correctly said that he is one, and that there is no one else except him. And to love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself is far more important than all the burnt offerings and sacrifices.' When Jesus saw that he had answered him wisely, he said to him, 'You are not far from the kingdom of God.' And no one dared to question him any longer." You know, we love to ask that greatest question, right? The greatest of all. What's the greatest empire? What's the greatest nation of all time? And you'll hear answers like, well, the Greeks, the Romans, of course, the United States of America. I mean, how can we not put that up there? There's all kinds of theories or all kinds of opinions about what the greatest empire is throughout all of history. Who's the greatest president of the United States that has ever lived? Of course, we'll hear Washington, maybe Lincoln. You probably have a favorite that you would throw out there. You would definitely have some that you would not put on that list. But we all have that idea of who the greatest president of all time has been. This question becomes... it's used in all kinds of ways. Who's the greatest athlete? Oh, don't get us started on that question. Who's the greatest athlete of all times? And there are a lot of opinions on the greatest athlete. But it's applied to movies. You guys have a favorite movie? I know some of the guys in this room have a favorite car of all time. I thought I'd get more of a response out of that one. Maybe a favorite book, or favorite musicians, or a band. We have favorites, and we all think that our favorite is the greatest. But what really defines the greatest of something? That's a very wide open question. Well, Jesus was asked, what is the greatest commandment of all time? What is the most important commandment in the Old Testament? The most important commandment God has given to us throughout all of history. What is the most important? And Jesus answered and said, "Listen, O Israel." Some translations may say, "Hear, O Israel." The Lord our God, the Lord is one. Jesus answers this question, what is the greatest commandment of all times? And he exposes some things about his listeners and to his listeners all at the same time. See, our reaction to Jesus' commands exposes our thoughts, our true intentions. It exposes what matters most to us, what is really going on in our lives. It can't hide from these questions that Jesus asks in Scripture. And here, Jesus was one to ask, but he turns it around and says, this is what the greatest commandment is, but it goes back onto you. And it becomes a question of, do you actually love the Lord your God? And that's a question that we all need to ask. Oh, I love church. That's not answering the question. Oh, I love some of the old hymns. That's not answering this question. Well, I love my church. I love the people of my church. Again, not answering the question. The question is, do you love God? That's the most important question. Do you love the Lord your God? Now, when Jesus answers this, and he's telling us in good faith, this is what you need to be doing, then we need to think, okay, do we really love God? And I think we can answer this in two ways. We won't break this up, but we need to really love God for who he is and with all that we are. We need to love God for who he is. Now, this part of this sermon really could be broken up into probably a year-long study, but we're going to try to cover it in just the short amount of time that we have today. But we need to love God for who he is. When Jesus answers and quotes, really, he is quoting from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 and 5. To the Hebrews, this is called the Shema, which means listen or hear. They would say this prayer, and if you want to, go ahead and turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 6. And I want you to see this for yourself. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 and 5 says, and see if it sounds familiar to you at all. Listen, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Huh. Jesus is quoting these exact words to the answer of what is the greatest commandment. This was a prayer for the Hebrews. They would pray it the first thing when they woke up. That, God, I want to love you with all that I have. I want to love you because you are God and you are God alone. And then they would go through their days, and that was the first thing on their mind in the morning. And so it set up the rest of their days. And then when it came to the evening time, when they were ready to go to bed and shut down their minds, they would pray this prayer again. Because as they slept through the night, they wanted this to be in their subconscious. They wanted this to be in their dreams. They wanted this to be part of their rest, was to love God even in the times when I'm asleep. I want to love the Lord my God. And so he quotes to them something they are very familiar with. To us, it would be like saying the Lord's Prayer. Or maybe some of you may have memorized the Apostles' Creed. That would be just like this for the Hebrews. They all knew this. They could quote it on the spot. As soon as he said, listen, they started filling in the rest of the blanks. They knew where this was going. The Lord your God, the Lord is one. And that you are supposed to love God. And so let's talk about Loving God for who he is. This is a powerful statement and explains such things. It explains a lot of things in such uniqueness. And yet, it's also very directly answering the questions. What's the most important thing that our lives could be focused on? What's the most important thing that we could be thinking about, that we could be doing? What's the most important thing that to God is that we have a love relationship with him? That we know that God loves us and we are to love God. And it starts with loving God for who he is. Well, let's talk about that. The fact of God's existence is so apparent that the Bible never directly answers trying to prove God. Romans chapter 1 actually gives us an answer that throughout all of creation and even in our own consciousness, the evidence of God's existence has been around us all the time. There's no denying it. I know some people like to try to deny it. And I love having those conversations with those people. Because even some of the most hardened people against religion still deep down agree that there is evidence of some powerful being that started this all. That there is something that we cannot explain. And so whether they call it God or whether they call it some other supernatural entity of some sort, the evidence of God's existence has been there and it's never been proven in Scripture. It's what we call a presupposition to an argument. It is presupposed that there is a God. Now, when Jesus answers this and quotes a Hebrew saying, the Lord our God is one, that starts diving into some other things that he is exposing in his listeners and to his listeners, to us today. So we have to go back and we have to think about, if the Bible doesn't prove the existence of God, if it doesn't reveal the existence of God to us, what does the Bible reveal about God? Well, it reveals to us God's nature and God's character and God's work. Let's talk about each of those for a little bit. His nature, God's nature. See, God is spirit. God's a spiritual being. He is a supernatural being, which means he goes beyond what we can see or prove in nature. That's why science has a hard time studying God, because it's beyond our understanding of nature that God exists. It's beyond what we can see, what we can touch, what we can feel. God is intangible to those things because he is spirit. So therefore, it's hard for some people to believe in God or for them to know God, because we want to touch, we want to feel. Sometimes when we've had our hard days, if we could let God come down and give us a big hug and tell us it's going to be okay. Or sometimes some of us stubborn people need God to come down right face to face and say, would you knock it off? Maybe a little slap on the head saying, would you stop it? You know, I grew up in church and I loved the old ladies that were in our church when I was a kid. But some of them, man, they know how to flick the back of your head and it hurts. I may have a little PTSD over that. But we want those tangibles. The hard part is God's nature is supernatural. He's spirit. He is beyond those tangible things. Yea, he wants to reveal himself to us. He wants us to feel close to him. So how do we feel close to something we can't see, something we can't touch, something we can't hear? Well, we have to work harder at it. We're not very good at feeling close to some of the things we can see and touch and hear all the time. There's some people that they're inside of a marriage and they haven't loved their partner in a long time. There are kids who grow up in homes seeing their parents, but yet they don't feel the love from their parents. Because even though they're right in front of them, they don't get that time and attention and affection the way that they need. So how do we do this with God? If God is nature, God in his nature is spirit, and he wants to love us, we have to understand that he does exist, and he's with us all the time. Part of his nature, he is eternal. He has always existed. He's been there from the day you were conceived. He will be there the day that you die. He is with you. He loves you. Yes, even if you have turned your back on God and have done some horrible things, God does not base his love towards you on your behavior. He bases it on who he is. See, the Bible tells us God is love. That's part of his nature. It's also part of his character, and we'll get there. But the fact is that God is love. So therefore, he has always loved us. And even in his judgment to us or towards others around us, in his judgment, he still is loving. There's a hard one to understand. But God is infinite. He's incomparable. He is unchanging. He has always existed. He will always exist. He knows all things. He is everywhere all at once. He is all powerful and has all authority. Now, I know, like I said, this study could go on for a long time, and we could break each one of those down, and I would love to. I've done that study. I still keep doing that study because knowing the nature of God is just so amazing and awesome to think that there is a God out there like this, but there is the only one God that is like this. The things that we describe about God's nature, there is only one God that fits all of these things. And that is the God of Scripture, the God of the Bible. There are other smaller gods that people believe in, but they don't match up to the nature of the one true God. Then we go on to, after we have studied, well, I'll go back to this. One of the statements that the Baptists have put in our Baptist Faith and Message, it's a small document that explains all of the different levels and all the different focuses of our belief. It's a very detailed booklet. This is the quote that it says. It says, "The eternal triune God reveals himself to us as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit with distinct personal attributes, but without division of nature, essence, or being." You got all that? It's on the test. No. Here's the bottom line, and I'll just sum it up this way. The Bible tells us about God's nature, but the reality is God still is a mystery. Even after all these years of studying and searching, there are some aspects of God that we don't understand and we cannot explain. I loved, there's this one video, and it's kind of a comedy skit in a way, of someone trying to say, explain the triune God that you talk about in simple terms, because we're uneducated people. And then he starts listing out all these ideas, and they're like, no, that doesn't fit, that doesn't fit, that doesn't fit. And then finally, out of frustration, he just says something like what I just read. And they're like, well, why didn't you say so in the first place? Because even though we can't understand all of it, that makes sense. Trying to put God into a box where we know exactly everything about God, that is something that is wrong. God is bigger than any box we can put him in. And so, God is a mystery, but the real bottom line is this. He has revealed himself to us, and he wants to reveal himself to us. There are some things that we're not going to know until we are face to face with God in heaven. But as long as we are here and we are searching after God, God says he will reveal himself to us. I had a friend put it this way. When his kids were little, he would play hide and go seek with his kids, right? And being a good dad, of course, dads never want to lose a game, even with a toddler. So we play hide and go seek, he said. He's like, I would go and I would hide. I would make sure that I would hide. And so the little toddler is over in the corner and, you know, 1, 2, 9, 10, ready or not, here I come. I don't know if he knew how to count, but then he would turn around and his dad's gone. Dad's hidden. He would start looking for him and he couldn't find him. So the toddler, because of now out of fear, would start crying. So the dad had to come out of hiding and says, no, I'm right here. I didn't leave you. So let's play the game again. Now the kid goes back. Okay, daddy. Turns. 1, 2. Ready or not, here I come. And the dad was standing right there. That's the way God is with us. God's not trying to hide himself so that we have to go looking. And we have to try to figure out codes and we have to try to answer these serious questions. God's, because he loves us and he wants us to know him, he's sitting right there in front of us and says, come find me. That's his nature. His character is that God is just, meaning that he delivers justice and may not be what we would call fair, but it is very just. It is according to his rules, not our understanding of rules. He is very loving. He is very truthful. That's one of my favorite attributes. God never lies to us. God cannot lie. So when God looks at me and he tells me that he loves me, then I have to believe him because he cannot lie to me. But God, have you seen the things that I've done? I see those things, but I still love you. I don't believe you, God. Why not? God is truthful. God can only tell us the truth. Sure, he may be disappointed with things in my life, but he never stops loving us. He is holy, which means that he's set apart. He's different than anything that we can ever imagine. There is a purity and a quality about him that makes him different than everything else. He is holy. See, God judges sin, and that's the part no one likes to talk about God. That God judges our sins, our mistakes, our failures, yes, he does judge them. But at the same time that he judges our sins, he comes up and he says, if you confess your sin, if you admit to your sin, I will forgive you and cleanse you from all of your sins. I will wipe them away. I will cast them as far as the east is from the west. You know what's interesting about that? I love this part. If you go east, do you ever stop going east? Even if you make it all the way around the world and you still keep heading east, you're going to keep heading east. And so if you head west, if God casts our sin as far as the east is from the west, that means it's gone. It's never to be brought up again. It's done. And so God shows us grace and mercy and compassion. That's his character. That's who he is. But then we have to talk about what he does, his work. Because of God's nature and God's character, God's work remains true and it remains holy. See, we cannot understand God without looking at what he has done. He is creator. He made this world that we live in. Except for there's only one difference I have to point out. The world that he created for us was perfect. The world we live in today is not perfect because we have messed it up. But God created a perfect world for us. He is creator. He is sustainer. Things still exist only because God holds all things together. He is redeemer. He takes what we have messed up and he reclaims it and he makes it new again. He is redeemer. His eternal plan is being completed since the beginning of time until the completion of all things. If you want to say it in a churchy kind of way, God's going to make sure from Genesis chapter 1 to the end of Revelation, it's going to be done. Anything that God has said he's going to do, he will do. And he draws all people unto himself. He brings people closer to him. So again, just like our illustration of a guy with his kid playing hide and go seek, God's saying, come find me. And if you can't find me just because you turn around and I'm too far away, you know, because babies don't have great eyesight. So in order for a baby to have to see you, you have to get closer. God will draw all people. He will bring them to himself so we can see him better. And that's all because of who God is. He loves us. And his work is that he's going to do all things to prove to us his love. He's also just, and so he's going to have to call for the day with whether you're ready or not. If you have not put your faith in Jesus, that's it. But you will have no excuse saying that, God, you never showed me your love. God, you never showed me that you're real. God is constantly working to show us those things. So loving God for who he is, I love this idea. And I love how Jesus brings us to that point of that's where we start. To love God, love the one true God. Because if we do that, we get rid of all the other false ideas of God. And when we study God for who he is, any of our ideas about God have to be tossed out. Because God says, no, that's not me. That's your idea, or that's some other person's thoughts about me. Don't believe those. Let me tell you about who I really am. And he does that through Scripture, through the Bible. But when we study God for who he is, it keeps us from having a self-made God. A false God. An idol. Because God doesn't match any idea of God. He is bigger than all of that. And so if we start with loving God for who he is, and we study who he is, it keeps us from getting off track with thinking about God. And so in good faith, God says, start with this. Love the Lord your God. Love God for who he is. And then he says, Jesus tells us, but then you also have to say to love God with all that we are. See, look back at Mark. He says, O Israel, love the Lord your God. The Lord is one. Then he moves on to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. So what part of your life is not covered with those four things? That's all of us. That's everything about us. Let's break those down a little bit. To love the Lord your God with all your heart. Now, this is not talking about the physical muscle beating inside your chest. That would be kind of weird. There was a movie about loving an idol or loving a God, not the one true God, but loving a God with a physical heart. And it was a gross scene where they ripped a heart out of a person. It was Indiana Jones, in case you are all wondering. It was scary to traumatize kids, but that's not what we're talking about. We're not talking about ripping out your physical heart and saying, "Here, God, here's all of it." No. Loving God with all of our heart speaks about our emotions. Speaks about the real you when no one's watching. The things that you feel. The things that you are passionate about. The things that you really, that you would define as love. Our English language is weird. We love all kinds of weird things. You can love your spouse, your husband or wife. You can love your kids. They're not the same. You can love ice cream. And if you love ice cream the way you love your kids, that would be weird. We love all of those things, but we have a different kind of love. Here, our heart speaks about what we genuinely are. We love our emotions, and we're supposed to love God with all of our heart. So more than you love a sports team, or more than you love a book, or more than you love a musician, you need to love God first. And so if you love God with all your heart, then you got to move on to love the Lord your God with all your soul. This is more about who you really are, just in general, your personality. Your soul is what's going to live on forever. So you are supposed to love God with all of your passions and all of your gifts and all of your talents and all of just the way that you were made to love God with your soul. You can also apply this that we need to have soul in our love for God. And that can be taken lots of different ways. I'll let you kind of dive into that one. But we need to love God not just with all of our heart, the things that we love, but with all of who we are as a person, all of our soul, what makes us us, what makes us unique compared to other people. Love God with that. And then to move on, to love the Lord your God with all your mind. This is your ability to reason, your ability to comprehend, your ability to think. I think, therefore I am, right? But to love God with all that we think about, with all of our thoughts, that means we need to think about God at work. We need to think about God at home. We need to think about God when we rise up and when we lay down. See, in Deuteronomy chapter 6, it says that they would do this everywhere they went, even in the grocery store. How often do you think about God in the grocery store? And not just praying, "God, please make these prices change again and go down." Or as sometimes I've found myself and I've had to ask for forgiveness for those ones, "God, please move this person out of my way. Because I know exactly what I need and they're just staring at the shelf." No, we need to think about God in such a way, "God, you provide all this." And just thinking about that, letting our minds dwell on what God has done and who God is, helps us to reason and have those answers for our own brain. To love the Lord your God with all your strength. Well, some of us are strong, some of us not so much. I love this, that it says it doesn't matter whether you're a strong person or not. Can you lift lots of weights? Can you? I was watching just the other day a strongman competition. I don't know why anybody would even think about doing some of the things they ask them to do. Why do you have to pull a semi-truck with a rope? We created them with engines and transmissions for a reason. They can go forward on their own. But we have strong men who can pull a semi-truck. Why do we have to prove our love for God with a physical act? No, that's not what it's talking about. To love the Lord your God with all your strength means your physical abilities, our willpower. Some of you, your strength is in some of your creativity. Love the Lord your God with all of your strength, which means be creative for God. Love the Lord your God with all your strength. Some of you are strong at cooking food. You need to love the Lord your God by cooking food. And I would be glad to support that. Some of you are artistic. Love the Lord your God with all of your art. Some of you are able to do physical acts. Love the Lord your God with what you're able to do. All of your strength means that it's to love God with what you are physically able to do and do that. But going back to this, I had to note something. In one of my early Bible classes, I was taught this. If a word is repeated over and over and over and over and over again, you should pay attention to it. That means there's something there you need to know. Because some of us are dense, and so we need it repeated multiple times. So as we're looking at this, what word is repeated over and over again in this verse? All. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. The repetition of this word all means that there is no room for a half Christian or a part-time believer. There is no room for just a casual relationship with a God. Could you imagine at a wedding ceremony, I promise to love you 3/4 of the time? Or looking, as we sing about, looking at a newborn baby and say, you know what, I'm really going to love you for about 5 or 6 years, and then I'll tolerate you. When we say we love God with all that we are, with all that we have, it is a call for us to completely and totally give God everything. Our struggles, our trials, our victories, our proud moments, our not so proud moments. God wants all of it because he wants all of us. Love the Lord your God with all. These things, gotta just finish with this. When Jesus says for us to love the Lord our God with all that we have, so to love God for who he is and with all that we are, it's not a call just to get by. And it's not a call for us to do something for God. See, he has already proven that he has loved us. He sent his son to die for us. He's already proven that he loves us. 1 John talks about that. What this is calling us to do is to recognize God's love for us and for us to love him back. Not to earn something, just to say, God, thank you for loving me, and so I'm going to love you. These are things that I do because I am loved by God, and I want to show him I love him as well. So the call, again, going back to it, the challenge, what I want us to think about today and what I want us to answer, and you can only answer this for you. Jesus says the greatest thing for us to do, the greatest thing for us to know, is to love God first. So do you love God? Do you love God with all that you have? Do you love God for all that He is and all that He has done for you?